Well, when I first arrived to LA, I didn't know what to do at all. I had no friends, I didn't know where to go, so I just kind of took it upon myself to learn things. Of course, I went on Craigslist.
Saying an independent film, they needed a woman in my age range, so I submitted my headshot and resume. I got a call to come in, and when I came to the casting, it was in an apartment building.
Hello and welcome to the Matt's Movie Reviews podcast. I'm your host, Matthew Pekovic, and this is episode number 193. Now available on demand on Amazon Prime and also in Vimeo for all other territories is Rocking the Couch, a documentary that explores a very relevant and controversial issue in pop culture today, sexual abuse within the entertainment industry. Joining me now to talk about Rocking the Couch and the many issues the film explores is the film's producer, writer, and director, Min Collins. Mina, thank you very much for joining me today.
Thank you so much, Matt, for having me on your show.
I'm really curious in regards to the timing of the movie. Was this documentary something you had in development before all the news broke in regards to the Me Too news and everything with Bill Cosby and such? Or was this something that just happened to happen, that coincided with all this breaking news that's happened over the last year?
Yes, what happened was that all the news were breaking on Bill Cosby and then Harvey Weinstein, Kevin Spacey, and working in the industry for so many years, I knew of so many actors that have had experiences in this, the casting couch. And I wanted to go ahead and try to present all these cases that are never heard, because basically, the news only covers the big conglomerate titans of the industry, and the smaller voices are always drowned out. So I thought by doing Rocking the Couch, I'll give an opportunity for these other voices that, a chance to speak up.
And you do a really good job of that as well, I may say. I really appreciate in the film that you spoke about or presented definitions, especially in the term casting couch. And this is a term that's been, to me, seems to be around for forever. But what's really interesting about this term is that, number one, I think it was first defined, was it back in the 1930s, I believe it was, that it was first defined, Min?
Yes, it was. It just started out once the industry, the film industry took a hold. What happened was that it became something that, a term that if you wanted to get into the industry and you're willing to do certain things, the casting couch, that term was coined back in those days. And it just referred to people that are willing to sleep the way to the top.
And the other interesting thing in regards to the term is that I'd say probably about 99% of the time, casting directors isn't directly involved with anything in regards to a casting couch, are they?
Correct. Yeah, casting couch doesn't refer to the casting directors because they're the ones that are actually bringing the actors. I think what it came down to was that there's always a couch in the producer's office. And anytime when someone wanted to try out for a role and they were put in front of a producer or a director, a lot of times they'll come into his office. And then, of course, that's when all the term was coined because all the things were happening on that couch.
And the other really important thing I think you show in the documentary is that while Me Too is happening now and social media bringing to light a lot of these kind of cases, these kind of things has been happening for quite a while. One case that you referenced was the case with Fatty Arbuckle. I think that was back in early 1920s when he was alleged to have been involved in a sexual abuse case. It was like a huge controversial case at the time. The media took a lot of liberties in regards to stories that came from the case. A lot of things were fabricated. It destroyed his career pretty much. So this thing has been around for a while. In fact, I remember even Errol Flynn at one time was under charge of statutory rape back in like the 1930s and 40s. So I think it's really important for people to know that this is not a very present issue. This thing has been around for a long time.
Yes, absolutely. Everything has been going on for years and years. And that's what we pointed out in the documentary, because as a case in Fatty Arbuckle, he was indicted. They had three cases where, he was basically in during his trial. And then eventually he was acquitted. and nothing ever was done, you know, with that case. And the woman that was involved, eventually, you know, that actually was raped by him, she died 3 days after. And that, you know, that was major headlines. I think what happened over the years is that there's so many cases that did bring about or could have brought about a change. And I think Hollywood, for some reason, have always been able to stash it away or, you know, sweep it under the table. It's not until recently with the Me Too movement and the Time's Up movement that, you know, all these voices are finally uniting and it's finally able to get a voice that people are starting to listen and starting to make a difference.
And I think what's really important with your documentary is that while Me Too and Time's Up, the stories in regards to that movement has to do with a lot of like A-list talent, people we would know.
Yes.
Underneath that, you have the extras, you have the voice actors. So many women, even in some cases, men as well, have been harassed, have been abused. A lot of these people appear in your documentary. When it came to getting testimony from these women especially, how did you go about doing this? Are these people you know personally? Are these people that came up to you? I mean, how does that process begin? Because I'd imagine that a lot of people, even though the issue is very relevant, this is something that's very private to them, and they might not have an outlet to talk about what happened to them in the past.
Yes, you're absolutely right. What happens is that when we started this documentary, we knew of between my producer and myself, we knew a lot of actors that pretty much every actor in Hollywood has a story, unfortunately. Some form of a story in, you know, that regards to the casting couch. So what we did was that we contacted all our friends, peers. One of my producer has been in the film industry. She's been an actress, and I believe, like, since 10. Her name is Andrea Evans. So she's grown up with so many named actors over the years, so many big A-listers have gone on, you know, to do big movies. That's how we were able to reach out to, you know, Carrie Mitchum, who is the granddaughter of Robert Mitchum. And all these people were willing to talk on camera because their stories at this point, they thought would help the industry and help us, you know, prove our point and get the message out. There's a woman that's in our documentary that originally she wanted to come on board and tell her story. And I think it's the one that she's silhouetted in the documentary.
Yes.
And so originally she came out and we did the whole segment on her story because I thought it was so fascinating what she did because she was so careful about, you know, doing the right thing. She went out with an agent, a high-powered agent, and ended up getting date raped. Well, you know, I mean, she did all the right thing by not going to his place, but she went out to a bar with him. And yep. Then, you know, she ended up, you know, in his bedroom at 3 a.m, waking up and realizing, what am I doing here? But originally she came out and we did all of her segment in front of the camera with her, you know, visible. But then a couple of days later, she called me back and said, hey, Min, you know, all these emotions that happened back in those days after I did this interview with you came back. And I'm really concerned about, you know, what I'm doing now. I don't want this to come out and hurt my career. Can we, you know, what can we do? You know, she wanted not to have that segment in the project. And I thought, well, this is such a powerful piece of the documentary that I talked her into doing, still having it in there. But let's just, you know, let's do your part with you silhouetted. So that way, at least we can get your story out.
And I think...
But it's,
go ahead.
Yeah, but it's... Yeah, but it's a very hard subject matter because a lot of times when people have these types of experiences, they really don't want to come out and talk about it. It's very embarrassing. A lot of times they feel that it's their fault that they put themselves in these situations. There's just so many things that goes into their minds that when it comes time to talking about something like that, it's very hard, and they really don't want to rehash that experience.
And something that really kind of angered me was that while even some people do come forward and would say, talk to their respective union, be it SAG, be it the Directors Guild, for example, there is a refusal to either assist them or they sweep it under the carpet. With some cases, I mean, there was one testimony that was shared in your film that one person said that they were threatened to be blacklisted. I mean, is this something that's still going on now, especially these days when a lot of this stuff has come out into the open?
I believe so. Just because everything that is going on with the Me Too and the Time's Up, where there's a platform that someone can actually go and you know, and talk about it and expose that, you know, those individuals that are doing the wrong things, I still think there is that threat in the industry that if you're going to do something like that, there's still that repercussion of someone saying, hey, I'm going to blackball you and you're probably never going to work in this industry again, especially, you know, the powerful people in this, those situations, you know, they can do that still.
An interesting thing, you mentioned Kerry Mitchell, who is, of course, the granddaughter of, Kerry Mitchum, who's the granddaughter of Robert Mitchum.
Yes.
Her story was a little different. She didn't have a case of sexual abuse in the industry. She was talking about how, because she essentially came from Hollywood royalty, and she shared a story about one of Jack Nicholson's daughters also comes from Hollywood royalty, that no one would dare touch him. I mean, that was a really kind of interesting thing that I saw from that perspective.
Yes.
When it comes to people who are brazen and criminal enough to attempt to do something like sexual harassment to someone in Hollywood, does a lot of it have to do with that they know they wouldn't face any repercussions, considering how fresh-faced or how unknown a certain target or a certain actress is?
Yes, that's a big part of it, because you get a lot of times you get these cases where these gigantic or casting directors, or not casting, but agents or producers or directors, they'll target someone that are unknown, just because if anything like this ever to come up, who would people believe, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, for instance, the same thing with Harvey Weinstein or Bill Cosby. Who would believe someone that is an up-and-coming actress compared to these gigantic people in the industry? Why would someone believe these people? Because, you know, the first thing I think people will always try to blame is, someone that's up and coming, they're going to be trying whatever they can to make it in the industry. And this could be a blackmail case or something that, you know, they're trying to get to the next step. So it's much easier to pick on those people that are up and coming as opposed to someone that's well established. Not in all cases, though, because look at the Harvey Weinstein case. All of his actors, or a lot of them, are some of them are A-listers, but he was so big in the industry that maybe, since he's able to give so many people chances and stardom in the industry, that he just, you know, didn't disregard that aspects of it. Again, there's also people in the industry that he's worked with that have gone on and became really big and have made their careers because of him. And they don't come out and talk about, hey, I did these things, so look at where I'm at now. You know, those people aren't speaking up at all.
There was an executive producer who appeared in your documentary, and he suggested that in some cases, some allegations were from actresses who were trying to maybe make some headlines for themselves in the industry. Is that something that's actually you've actually seen in action? Do people actually would take advantage of something like that and exploit it for their own gain?
I definitely think there are people that will do that to exploit those kind of situations so they can be in the limelight. For instance, you know, just recently someone was in the news and they said that. What was it? He was attacked by, you know, a couple.
Oh yes, Jesse Smollett, I think it was from
right.
That. Was a show, Empire. I think the show
Empire,
was called.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And it's just almost the same kind of a case where someone who wants more publicity and is doing something to, you know, get themselves in the limelight, and I'm sure that happens the same as women who are trying to, let's say, blackmail somebody to get themselves notice.
An interesting debate that has come out of this is when it comes to, say, a movie star who's been found guilty of crimes. So, say, a Kevin Spacey or a Harvey. Well, I'm not going to say found guilty, but have alleged to have become, have done crimes, and the evidence seems overwhelmingly that they have. When it comes to someone like a Kevin Spacey or a Bill Cosby, for etc., or a Roman Polanski who was actually convicted of something like that back in the 70s. When it comes to their art, can a movie fan, do you think that a movie fan can still watch, say, The Usual Suspects or Chinatown, knowing that they were part of such nefarious activity? I mean, my opinion on the thing is that sometimes you have to separate the art from the artist. That doesn't necessarily mean you have to promote anything new that they have post the allegations. But right. Can you, for example, still watch Chinatown even though you know what Roman Polanski did all those years ago?
Sure. Myself as a filmmaker, I can, just because the art doesn't – I can separate the two. I know a lot of my friends who have watched my documentary or we talked about these cases – and a lot of them say, well, you know, if someone really did something like that, I can't see them in the same light, so yeah. I can't watch their movie. But, you know, this is art. This is something that they did as a talent, you know, not to take a talent away from somebody. Kevin Spacey is still an amazing and talented individual.
True.
Yep. You know, right? And so just because he did something that he's not supposed to doesn't mean that his work isn't still amazing. So I can still separate that, but I know for a fact that some people who have, I guess, looked at the allegations and now they see someone in a different light.
Do you think sometimes, at least stepping forward into the future, in order to get progress on this issue of sexual abuse within Hollywood, sometimes it has to come down to the big time players within the industry to perhaps refuse to work with certain people who have been alleged of crimes? I mean, for example, Emma Thompson has stepped away from a movie that was to be directed by John Lasseter, who came from Pixar and Disney. He had several allegations towards him in regards to his conduct towards women. Do you think in the future that's something that's going to happen? Do you think a lot of actors, A-list players specifically, need to step away from working with certain people to say to other people, look, we're not going to tolerate this anymore, and we will not work with you until you get your house in order?
Absolutely. I believe that has to be something that needs to take place. Otherwise, there won't be any changes because, you know, there's no repercussion for something that someone does that's not acceptable. Then it's never going to change, right? So in order for those kind of changes, you've got to have the people on, up in the top levels to say, hey, if you're doing that kind of stuff, we're not going to work with you. And if we do work with you, then what's going to make them change?
Well, I mean, I got to say that your documentary was very insightful, very informative as well in regards to how this plague that's taken over the industry for quite some time now affects everyone on all levels of Hollywood and even outside as well. I think there were some stories from New York City as well that are in your documentary as well. So I think it's a really important documentary. So everyone out there, rocking the couch, for Australian viewers, you can check it out on Amazon Prime. For everyone else around the world, available on Amazon, Amazon Prime, and Vimeo as well. Thank you very much for joining me today, and best of luck with the documentary.
Thank you so much, Matt, and really appreciate you having me on the show. Thank you so much for promoting the documentary, because I think it's something that it needs to be, stories that need to be heard, and also, in order for a change to take place like we talked about, people need to know, and that's the only way changes are going to occur. And I really appreciate you spreading the word.